Okay.
Maybe we can continue. So in the first couple of lectures, you've heard about supervised learning, and we've looked a little bit at restricted Boltzmann machines and deep belief networks, right? And we looked a little bit of justification for training these models one layer at a time, and there is a very nice mathematical underpinnings behind these models. So let me talk about the other class of models. These are called Boltzmann machines or deep Boltzmann machines. It's a sort of very much in flavor similar to deep belief networks, but have a little bit of a different architecture and a little bit different learning algorithm. So if I compare both models, if you look at the overall structure of both models, deep belief network, as I mentioned, has this interesting structure, which is an undirected graph followed by a sigmoid belief network. And in a Boltzmann machine, you can think of the entire system as being an undirected graphical model. So you can think of it as a Markov random field with layers of hidden variables. Now, deep belief networks are hybrid models. So in particular, doing proper inference in these models is actually pretty expensive. And so you have to use an approximation, which is a recognition model. There is also, in these kinds of algorithms, there is also a greedy pre-training, so there is no joint optimization over all layers at the same time. There have been a few attempts, but typically it's a very hard thing to do. And in the approximate inference, is just a feed-forward inference. So given the input, you just try to infer the states of the hidden variables in a feed-forward way, and that's your answer. So let me just show you a couple of examples of these models. So here what you're doing is you're introducing dependencies between hidden variables, and all connections are undirected. So what changed from before is, in addition to this term that looks at the pairwise, you can think of these as pairwise potentials between these variables, you're just introducing these two additional terms, right? So they're modeling dependencies between H1 and H2 and H2 and H3. So multiple layers. And obviously you can incorporate or you can introduce different kinds of structures, but this is one instance. And if you actually want to compute the probability of a particular variable taking value 1, so a unit taking value 1, it really depends on what's coming from above and what's coming from below. Right, so at some point, instead of just being a feed-forward inference, you will have to use some kind of approximate inference algorithm that will have you so that you know there is some consistency between bottom-up and top-down for this particular variable being taking value 1. Now, if you compare these kinds of models to traditional neural network models are just feed-forward and they're deterministic. So given input, you produce some output, right? In these models, you're actually trying to model the distribution over the input space. If you look at models like deep belief networks, again, that's the overall architecture for these models. But if you look at the inference in your standard deep belief network models, then effectively the inference is the same as having a feed-forward neural network. So for these generative models like deep belief networks, the inference is really just a feed-forward approximation over the states of these variables. It's a feed-forward inference. So let me give you a little bit of intuition of what can we do, what kind of learning happens in these models. Well, if you look at the maximum likelihood learning, it has exactly the same form as what we've seen for Boltzmann machines and for Markov random fields, the same learning rule as if you're working with Markov random fields, conditional random fields. You're just trying to match expected sufficient statistics. Right, so these expected sufficient statistics driven by the data, these expected sufficient statistics driven by the model, and just trying to match the two. That's the maximum likelihood learning. And in this case, because you're introducing dependencies between hidden variables, both expectations are intractable. So you sort of have to design some algorithm or some procedure for approximating both of them. So it's one of those things that you're making your model more expressive, but at the same time, inference becomes more difficult. But let me give you an intuition what these two terms are doing. One thing I want to point out is the reason why this expectation is intractable is because computing this conditional probability is no longer possible. So it's no longer a factorial distribution. It really is, conditional some input. If I'm trying to infer the state of this variable, it really is depend on the input, but also on the states of these variables, right? So there has to be some kind of procedure for approximating that conditional probability. But let me give you an intuition of what's happening here. What's happening here is, let's say I see some data, and this is what I get to observe. Intuitively, what I'd like to do is I'd like to assign some probability mass to these data points, because this is what I see. That's the real data. And that's essentially what the first term is trying to do. But then if I look at this exponential space and I look at that image, right, I want to assign small probabilities. In fact, I want to assign exponentially small probability. And that's essentially what this term is doing. If you think about the partition function here, which is a normalizer, it's essentially the job of the partition function. The derivative of the log of the partition function is just the expected sufficient statistics, so we're trying to approximate that. And that generally is a difficult problem. So what can you do here? Well, one thing you can do is you can use variational inference to approximate these expectations, and you can use Markov chain Monte Carlo based approximation to estimate these expectations. And the natural question is, why do you do that? Why can't we use MCMC to approximate both of these expectations? Obviously, anytime you're computing expectations, you can run Markov chain. Valid question, I'll get to that. Or why can't we use some deterministic approximations over here? Like if you've heard about variational approximations or Betta approximation, maybe you can use that there. And there is also good reason why it's difficult to do it using some of the variational techniques for approximating these expectations. So there's been a lot of work in the late 90s, in the early 2000s, for dealing with that problem. And a lot of previous approaches were not very successful for learning both from machines where you have hidden variables. You have some non-trivial connections between hidden variables. Right? And if you look at a lot of algorithms, algorithm based on contrastive divergence, there are algorithms based on score matching, pseudo likelihood, composite likelihood, piecewise learning, MCMC, MLE, various different versions. It's kind of hard to get these models to scale to training large systems. Now, in fact, maybe I should point out, maybe with the advances of compute, maybe you can do that. But generally, it's been kind of hard to do. So let me give you an intuition what we're trying to do here. And this is true not just of a Boltzmann machine, but any type of Markov random field where you have, you know, complicated relationship between the hidden variables. So the first thing you need to do is you need to infer the distribution of a hidden variables, right? You need to somehow approximate this quantity. Because given the data, I want to figure out what's the posterior distribution of the states of these variables. Imagine that if I want to use it for, let's say, classifying what I'm seeing in the data. So I need to solve this problem. On the other hand, I can simulate from the model. See if the simulation runs. No, it doesn't. But say I can simulate from the model. I can run the simulation and look what's being produced here. Okay. So that gives me some approximate of this distribution. Right, and let's say my simulation looks like this. If I have an approximation to this conditional and I have some approximation in the joint, I can actually estimate these data-dependent expected sufficient statistics, and I can estimate the data-independent sufficient statistics, what the model is telling me, and I'm trying to match the two. What's the intuition? The intuition here is that if I look at the distribution generated by my model, I'm basically trying to make sure that it kind of fits the distribution that I see in the data. That's just an intuition. Now, what's happening here is if I look at this space is in the space of H and V is very multimodal space. If I'm working in the space of all possible characters, all possible images, it's a very multimodal space, right? In fact, it's very difficult to approximate this multimodal space. And we've tried and been a few papers showing that it's very hard to approximate this space very reliably using variational approximations. MCMC works a bit better, not perfect, but there are tricks for exploring this multimodal space. On the other hand, given a particular input, if I slice in that space and I see what's the posterior probability of the latent variables in that slice, I would expect this posterior probability to be not as complex as the entire joint space, right? Which is to say, you know, it could be, typically would contain a single mode. Perhaps sometimes it contain, you know, a couple of modes. If you really believe, given this data, there are two different alternative ways of explaining what you're seeing in the data, right?
This is modes in the input.
In the posterior.
Posterior, yeah.
That's right. Modes in the posterior. Now, there could be some cases, you know, I show you an input and you say, yeah, it could be a dog or it could be a car. I don't know. And that basically would say there are two alternative explanations. But in general, the way you're training these systems, you expect the posterior to be unimodal. This is one answer to what you're seeing in the data. So that gives you sort of an intuition that you can use variational and inference, and particularly you can use something that's called mean field approximation, which is very efficient. It's deterministic. That can give you fairly good representation of the mode, the single mode, and you can use stochastic approximation, which is MCMC based. So let me first point out what this thing is doing. Yes?
Is the posterior typically concentrated, let's say, or unimodal, like towards the end of the training or throughout the entire training?
Good question. I'll come back to that once I describe the algorithm. Yes, so there are drawbacks to this algorithm, obviously. So let me just point out what this approximation is doing. And this is based on stochastic approximation. And the idea is actually that this particular approximation dates back to the works of Robbins and Monroe and Lauren Yanis. And the way that these algorithms work is you define a Markov chain. So let's say here you are trying to update the model parameters as well as the state x. So think of x as the entire state of all the variables in your Markov random field sequentially. So you're generating the new state from some transition operator by simulating from a Markov chain that leaves p theta sub t invariant, so the current distribution invariant. So it could be, for example, be a Gibbs sampler, which is efficient. You can implement it. And then you're going to be updating the parameters of the model by replacing this expectation with a point estimate that you get out of your Markov chain. And in practice, you're simulating several Markov chains in parallel, and then just average. This is sort of an interesting process because what this is doing, this is saying that I'm updating, you know, I'm simulating and updating parameters. I'm simulating, updating parameters. So your stationary distribution changes as you're learning. And in fact, this particular algorithm was precisely this version of the algorithm was developed by Lauren Yanis in 89. It was published in a French math journal, I believe. And so nobody knew about this algorithm. And so we've developed, you know, there's been a lot of developments of contrastive divergence, and there are a few persistent contrastive divergence. There's a few iterations up until in late, you know, in 2000, people basically discovered that that belongs to Lauren Yanis. It's an interesting algorithm. You can show. I'll show you that you can show asymptotically converges to the stable point of low bound on a variational low bound on a log likelihood. But nonetheless, it's an algorithm. It's very easy to implement. And if I look at the whole algorithm, you can think of it as follows. This is the learning rule that I'm trying to approximate. Let's just consider that we can approximate these expectations or compute these expectations. This is what we get out of the Markov chain, right? What I can do is I can say, well, if I add and subtract the true expectations, then this is what I want to do. And this is, you can think of this as a noise term or some perturbation. You know, this is what I'm trying to compute, and this is what I'm getting out of my Markov chain. The trick here is, unfortunately, this is not an unbiased estimate of this expectation, right? Because this depends on how fast your Markov chain is mixing. If it's mixing very slowly, it's going to be a very poor biased approximation to this expectation. And so when you use these algorithms in practice, there is always a concern as to what is happening there. And then, yes?
Why is bias?
Well, because imagine that you're running your Markov chain. You can sort of, you know, if you run it up to infinity, then if you get samples from the true stationary distribution, then that gives you an estimate of the expectation, right? But if my Markov chain is not mixing, there is no reason to believe that this is an unbiased estimate of this expectation. Let's say you have a Markov chain that just doesn't move, it stays where it is. Right? then it's a poor approximation. But what you can show is you can show from theoretical perspective, which is to some extent is a little bit of a cheating. You can say, well, as your learning rate, this quantity, goes to zero, sufficiently, if it goes to zero at the rate slower compared to the mixing of the Markov chain, then it's okay. It's almost like saying my learning rate is sufficiently small so that then my Markov chain can reach the stationary distribution, and if it reaches the stationary distribution, then this term will go to zero.
Do you have any bounds on the mixing?
No, that's a problem. There are no bounds. It's an asymptotic result that says asymptotically, as the learning rate becomes sufficiently small compared to the mixing rate of the Markov chain, then it becomes obvious, right, that you know the Markov chain will mix. You get the samples from the stationary distribution of p theta sub t, and so this term can go to zero. But there are no bounds on the mixing rate, right? So it's just a theoretical.
So how do they in practice adjust?
Yeah,
this?
I'm going to show you. But this is sort of at least this is sort of telling you that asymptotically you're okay, right? But that result is kind of saying that you know if your Markov chain mixes or reaches stationary distribution, you're okay.
Is the mixing typically better towards the end of the training?
Or does it not change? There is some papers basically showing that generally mixing in these is. I'm going to show some examples. Is not really good. So you need to use something else. You need to use more advanced transition operators that you, because trying to go from one mode to another mode is a difficult problem, and that's. So it's you have to use some more advanced techniques to be able to explore that space, that exponential space, more efficiently. And that's just an approximation. There are no sort of proper bounds to tell you that if you run it for 1,000 iterations, you guarantee it for this error to be sufficiently small. So in high-dimensional data, the probability landscape is highly multimodal. But one of the things that you can do is you can say, well, these transition operators that operate in Markov chain can be any valid transition operator, right? So there are a lot of tools that have been developed in statistics using parallel, simulated tampering, tampering transitions that basically allow you to construct valid Markov chains that can potentially jump between the modes and mix a little bit faster. There is also a nice connection if you're interested in the theory of stochastic approximation and adaptive Markov chain Monte Carlo methods. That sort of again have nice theory and allow you to perhaps train these models a little bit better. There's a few papers on that. Now, this sort of you know tries to address this big problem. How do you deal with exploring exponential space? Let me now come back to the problem of estimating these expectations, and that turns out to be a much simpler thing to do. In the first part of the tutorial, I've mentioned the variation inference, but let me just remind you very quickly, for those of you who haven't seen this before, what's the trick. So let's say I'm trying to approximate this intractable distribution with a simpler distribution, perhaps tractable distribution Q, parameterized by some parameters mu. Okay? So you can think of this distribution as fully factorized distribution, or perhaps a Gaussian distribution, or something that you can compute. Something that you can, you know, sample from and be able to compute. So you can always write the log of the probability is the log of the sum. I can always multiply the divide by Q. Now there are a few conditions that Q cannot be zero where P is non-zero. Right? So that you don't have divisions by zero. Then you can use Jensen's inequality and pull the Q out. So this is just basically saying that log of the expectation is always greater or equal to the expectation of the log, right? By the convexity of the logs. And then if you plug in the definition of the model, you have this expression. You have this expression that P star means unnormalized probability. This is your partition function, and this is the entropy of your Q distribution. And if you haven't seen variational inference, it's sort of something magically happens. If you're trying to optimize this bound, you're trying to say push on this bound so that it's as tight as possible compared to my log probability of the data. This is what I'm trying to do. It's interesting, if you're optimizing with respect to Q, this log of the partition function, which requires exponential computation, basically disappears because doesn't enter into your optimization problem. which basically makes the whole algorithm be efficient. So you never need to compute partition function. It just becomes a constant, right? And if you look at the log of unnormalized probability, it's a log linear model. So these expectations are all linear in what you're trying to sum out. So this is known as a variational bound. You can also write this variational bound as a log probability of the data minus something's called KL divergence, Kubrick line divergence between Q and P. Right. This also has a very intuitive interpretation, which is basically saying you're trying to optimize for the parameters mu such that this KL divergence between these two distributions is as small as possible. So if it's zero, you get the tight bound. And so, you know, you try to minimize KL divergence between the approximate and the true distributions with respect to these parameters mu. And it turns out that if you choose one particular parameterization, there are many you can choose from, and there's a lot of work on perhaps using not just the mean field, but structured mean field or other types of... So for example, here, if you assume that your true distribution is fully factorized, it's essentially saying I'm breaking all the links in my model, then what it does is if you plug this in, you do a little bit of math, it comes down to being a sequence of nonlinear equations. Right, and surprisingly, a lot of them look like Gibbs updates. It's almost like doing Gibbs updates, but without actually sampling. So you cycle through these equations up until you reach the stationary.
Sorry, what do you mean by Gibbs update?
So if you look at these, equations, right? If you wanted to do Gibbs updates given the data, you would sample the states of the hidden variables, and you compute the conditional probability, and you sample. And turns out, for this particular model, the updates with the mean field, it's similar form, exact same form, as computing the probability of a particular hidden variable. But then instead of sampling, you're just keeping it. So it's almost like a Gibbs sampler without sampling. And you can show that that will reach, you will find the best approximation to the posterior that has this form, which is a fully factorized form. Intuitively, what it does is it will find a single mode in the posterior. It cannot find, because it's a fully factorized, you will only find one mode. And that comes back to somebody else's question, because what's happening during your learning, if your posterior is truly multimodal, what this procedure will do is it will select one mode and make it more probable. And as you're training, it essentially what the model will do is it will basically find... It will find a solution in such a way that your approximation to the posterior is pretty close to the true posterior. But maybe that will also result in, you know, you sacrificing a little bit of the log likelihood, because if the posterior is truly multimodal, you're forcing it to be unimodal. Right? So this is sort of, you know, if you look at the algorithm, it's almost a little bit similar to EM algorithm. In the E step, you're doing variational approximation, so you're approximating the posterior. In the M step, using stochastic approximation to update the model parameters. And again, under the theory, if you know, asymptotically, you can say that you will converge to some asymptotically stable point of the variational bound. So you'll reach some point. So inference is fast. One of the reasons to use the mean field inference, because it's an optimization problem, it can be fast. You just do a few iterations, and learning can scale to a million examples, because for estimating the data-independent statistics when you're running your Markov chain, these are data-independent, so you can just run them in parallel. So you can scale the system up. But let me show you, some of you probably seen this, you know, we can show almost sure convergence guarantees and whatnot, but the question is, does it actually work? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you two panels. On one panel, you will see the data simulated by the model. On the other panel, you will see real data. Okay? And you have to tell me which one is which. So these are handwritten characters coming from 50 different alphabets around the world, and just trying to train what these characters should look like. How many of you think this was simulated and this was real? What about the other way around?
Wait, where? Those letters?
Yeah. So let me show you again. So how many of you thought this was simulated, this was real? Good. What about the other way around? Great. It's like 50-50, which is good. So let me show it to you again. If you look at these samples, like for example, if you look at this example here, you will see it's not quite precise. It captures the overall structure of characters, but it's not as precise as, you know, filling in the pixels. The other interesting thing is that if you look at the real data, the diversity in the real data is much higher than what's simulated. And that has to do with the fact of exploration of this exponential space. Right? Because the Markov chain is not able to explore all of the space, which is quite complex.
So I think it's not clear what, I mean, this a real alphabet?
Yes, these are real alphabets.
All of the
GFAL alphabet. Yeah, so I should say these are 50 different alphabets. There's about 1,500 different characters that you're training. And then you're saying, can you actually generate me character from any one of those alphabets?
But you could memorize 1,500.
Good point. Good point, Sanjeev. Yes, I'll come back to that question. I can memorize, that's right. I could have memorized a lot of these things, and you wouldn't tell the difference. So in the last part of the tutorial, I'll show you some examples of how we can evaluate these models more precisely, as opposed to showing you examples.
Would you require some the description would be concise, that your network would be small compared to what is needed to memorize all of the data?
No, not really, because these models are quite big, inject lots of parameters. So in principle, it could memorize all of these examples. But I'm going to show you, it's actually, to the point, it's actually one of the biggest problems in our community right now, is because I can show you lots of examples, but there is very little quantitative evaluation of how good these models are in terms of, in terms of being able to generalize. I'm going to come to that point. Yeah. But I also wanted to point out that I've learned this trick from my neuroscience friends, that if I show you these things fast enough, you won't see the difference. Right. So, and these are just some other examples on the MNIST. So it does reasonably well. If you sort of apply these models, so one way of evaluating these models would be to say, well, given a new test set, find further distribution of the hidden variables and just fit a simple logistic regression on top. How well does it do, right? So these examples do show that you can do quite well compared to a lot of other algorithms. So it's not just memorizing in that sense. Because for a new test example, it's able to classify this character as belonging to one of the alphabets. This is a generative model of 3D objects. It's a much harder task, even though today there are much better models exist that I'll mention later. But you can see it sort of generates some interesting things. Like it generates this piece, which was very pleased with. It's like a car with wings, right? An airplane with car-like wings. So it tends to generate some interesting structure. And you can also do completion. So given half of the input, you do the completion. So that's another way of at least testing, is the system doing something reasonable, or it's completely memorizing.
So is there any kind of theory behind it? Is there any loss function that you can evaluate?
Yes, I'll come to that point. I'll be held responsible for answering that question. Is there a proper objective way of evaluating these generative models? Yes, I'll come back to that. There is. Okay, so where else can we use these generative models? So let me quickly show you some more applied stuff. So one of the other things that we've looked at for that particular model is looking at the domain of modeling multimodal data. So this example has been a few works of trying to, let's say you take images and text, can you model the two things together, right? And some of the challenges is, if you look at the space of images, it's typically dense, you're looking at pixels. If you look at the, If you look at the space of text, it's typically sparse and discrete. So you have very different modalities. So very difficult to learn these cross-modal features. We found it's quite challenging. The other challenge in a lot of sort of real-world data is that you have noisy or missing data. So this is an instance of a Flickr data set where you have images, and sometimes the text is missing. Or sometimes people are saying what kind of camera they use to take an image. So it's not very useful for identifying what you're seeing in the image. But if you built, there's a Boltzmann machine model, which is a modeling distribution of the inputs, this is what you can do, right? So it does sort of reasonably well in terms of producing distribution of the possible images. So one simple approach.
what you had on the right were multiple samples from the conditional distribution.
Oh, from the conditional distribution. So yeah, I'll be more precise. It is basically multiple samples from conditional distribution. Because you're modeling both of them, and just like pattern completion that I've shown, you condition on the image in this case, and you generate words from the conditional distribution. Yeah. So what you can do is you can sort of, people looked at constructing these kinds of models, but it's very difficult to learn these cross-model features. So we've done something fairly simple, which is to say, can you actually take images and can you actually take text, bring them to some level representation, and you're modeling dependencies between the two. And there's a lot of work nowadays trying to find some representation and then modeling a correlation, modeling dependencies between the learned representations. There is also a very natural notion of bottom-up and top-down in these models. So information from words can influence low-level features in images. And information in images can influence low-level representation of words if there is a need to do that. So this is some examples of, these are more or less reasonable ones. These are some examples where the model is failing. I just like to show these ones because they're fun to look at. As you look at this example, it's just Obama, Barack Obama, election politics. So we've tried looking at what's happening here. And what's happening there is, this was done on the Flickr dataset, and the Flickr dataset doesn't really have a lot of images of animals. But it has lots of Obama signs because it's like wasn't back in 2008. And so, you know, obviously you can see that these models do fail, and they can fail, particularly if you're looking at the inputs that are not represented in your training set. Let me also show you what the sampling procedure looks like. So let's say I condition on this image.
It has a prior, and the prior takes over because the posterior is too weak.
That's right. You basically, because in these kinds of models, so these are models. Yes, that's right. You basically, if you have only a few examples of things that you've never seen before, the posterior will just override it completely.
Yes.
Right, will override it, yeah. So this is an example of you take an image, you instantiate hidden states randomly, and you're running conditional on this, you're just running a system. So let me show you what it does. This is sort of fun to look at. So this is the system converging. And now it's step number 50. It says travel, trip, vacation, Africa, beach, ocean, wave, sea, sand, sea, beach, island, vacation. So it still is converging. Water, Canada, BC, British Columbia, Italy, water, sea, boat, Italia, sea, sky, blue, city, urban, color, Nikon, cloud, sky, D200. It's like Nikon, Taiwan, film, Taipei. So it just talks about, now it talks about California, beach landscape. So what happens here is you can see that there are multiple alternative explanations to what you see in the image. So there's multiple modes. And what the system is doing is the system is, it's like Mexico, Brazil. So it basically goes through these modes and has different explanations. So that could potentially be useful instead of just a simple tagging. The whole distribution of a possible alternative explanations to what you see in the images.
Alternative facts.
Alternative facts, that's right.
What was the training data? So tagged images?
Tagged images, that's all.
A million or something.
That's right. The data, this is what the data looks like. You have about a million images along with the user assigned tags. Right, so these are just random texts that people assign. And sometimes, you know, people use what kind of camera they use to take this image. And sometimes it's actually quite useful. It tells you what's exactly in the image. Sometimes it's missing. It's just whatever people feel like tagging. But it does basically figure out that if it's a scene like ocean we typically find, or like forest, people do tag a lot with what kind of camera they use to take a picture of that image. So it actually turns out to be quite useful feature for classification. If you want to classify what kind of scene it is, if people tag it, you know, what kind of camera they use, it's a very good feedback that it's actually seen as opposed to, you know, a building or a car. And this is just an example to show that if you're using these models compared to support vector machines and other kinds of models, these do well. But the important thing I want to emphasize here is that there are about 25,000 labeled examples, but there's a million unlabeled examples. And unlabeled examples here were helping quite a bit. So that was good news for us because we were learning unsupervised model, just modeling the joint distribution over the inputs. So all of these additional labeled data was helping us. Unfortunately, it's not the case for a lot of problems. But in this case, we did see some value from unlabeled data.
How were you using the unlabeled data?
Just the unlabeled data is used to build this model. When I talk about, let me specify. The data itself comes from images and tags. And then there is a supervised learning task, which is people took these images, and there are 37 classes, where they say, you know, this image is a multi-label classification problem, contains ocean, sea. Right. And then you're really trying to precisely classify what's in the image, right? But and so these additional...
How do you use the unlabeled data? Is it
you train this entire system in completely unsupervised fashion. You don't use the labeled examples.
Like
yeah, it's a Boltzmann machine. You're modeling the distribution over the inputs. And at test time, if you need to classify, then you take these representations, you infer the states of these variables, and you take these states of these variables and you classify, you put them into logistic regression essentially, and classify what it's the representation. That's right. So unsupervised, you know, unlabeled data was helping us to build a better generative model, which then helped us to solve a classification task. It was easier for us to solve the classification task. Let me also point out another class of models. No, you can. You can try it. Sure.
Why is this not semi-supervised?
It is semi-supervised, yeah. But you can use some graph-based
method. You mean like manifold learning?
Sure. No, we haven't tried that. That might help. So let me now jump into another class of models. In the last few years, these kinds of models, the variational autoencoders and Helmholtz machines, made a big comeback. And let me talk about this class of models. So these are probably the most popular models right now because there is a trick that allows these models to learn much faster. So back in 1995, there was a paper by Jeff, Peter Dayan, Brandon Frey, and Redford Neal where they've introduced something called Helmholtz machines. And again, these are just sigmoid belief networks. It's a generative process. You generate the input data. There is a recognition process. It was one of the earlier papers. And in the last few years, there was very nice work, particularly coming from Dirk Kingman and Max Welling, that showed that you can train these models efficiently using backpropagation algorithm. And these are stochastic systems. So if you compare these different kinds of models, you can see that all of them kind of have a similar structure. But semantically, they're all slightly different. This is an undirected model. You have to deal with partition function. These are purely directed models, right? But they have their own inference becomes much harder in these models. So let me tell you what the variational autoencoders are. So the variational autoencoders defines a generative process in terms of sampling or sensor sampling through the cascade of hidden stochastic layers, right? So I can write down there is a prior over the states of hidden variables, and then you generate the data. So theta is going to be denoting parameters of the variational autoencoders. L is going to be the number of stochastic layers. And you have to make sure that sampling and evaluating conditional probabilities for each term is tractable. It's a tractable operation. Right? So you have to make sure that this is tractable. So this is just one big gigantic DAG, basically. Now, one thing is each particular term here can denote a complicated nonlinear relationship. So each particular term can be a neural network sitting inside. Let me give you an example. So this is an example where you have two stochastic layers and one deterministic layer. And this essentially says this conditional probability denotes a one-layer neural network. In fact, recently there's been a lot of debate in our community saying maybe all we need is just need one stochastic layer and deterministic paths to generate the data. Why? In principle, I can take a Gaussian distribution, push it through multiple layers of nonlinearity, and I can model whatever I want. Right. in principle, I can take a Gaussian and morph it into a very complicated multimodal distribution. So this is the class of directed systems known as variational autoencoders.
So now, what does a stochastic layer look like?
It's just you can think of these as either. Let me make it precise as I define, because for variational autoencoders, it's actually very important what these stochastic layers are. These turn out you have to make them to be basically Gaussians.
So they are independent of their input?
A priori, yes. So the way you're generating the data, you sample the states of these variables, which could be a sample from the Gaussian, or could be a sample from uniform. You go through nonlinearity, you get to a Gaussian stochastic layer. Let's say these are controlling the means of the mean of this Gaussian, and then you generate the data. So the generative process is you sample from the prior, you generate the data. Obviously, the posterior is going to be complicated, which is given x. If you're trying to infer what's the posterior distribution over this, then it's it could be something complicated. But now let's look at variational bound. Again, these models are based on the variational bound argument, which is to say, if I have log probability of the data, I can write this expectation. It's always greater than this expectation. And notice that you have two terms. There is P of XH, which is your generative model. And then there is a Q of H given X, which is the approximation to the posterior. So you always have this generative and sort of approximate recognition model. Right? And so you're always trading the data likelihood and the KL divergence from the posterior. Now, these kinds of models have been developed back in late 90s. The issue is, how can you optimize this variational bound with respect to Q and P? And it turns out it's very hard to optimize the variational bound with respect to the recognition model. You hit high variance. So there was a class of algorithms called wake sleep algorithm that kind of was combined different objective functions.
What? What do you mean by the recognition network?
Oh, Q. So I should say this sometimes is called recognition network. Given the X, given the input, what's the distribution over the latent variables in your model? So that sometimes it's, I guess in machine learning, it's called the inference. You know, you're doing some kind of inference. If you're doing mean field inference, you're trying to find the best approximate fully factorized posterior. In these kinds of models, you're saying, well, it's parameterized by some parameters you're trying to optimize for Q. And the key idea of Kingman Welling was to use so-called Riptonization trick. It's a beautiful idea, very simple idea. But it turns out that it becomes very important. So let's say that your recognition distribution is a Gaussian. Okay, let's just make this assumption. So what you're saying is you're saying this hidden states at the layer above are going to be given by the mean and the variance. And the mean and the variance are going to be some functions of the hidden states, you know, a layer below. And notice that this itself can be complicated nonlinear relationships. So these themselves could be multilayered neural nets themselves, right? Alternatively, I can express this in terms of auxiliary variables. I can say, well, I'm going to be sampling epsilon from normal zero identity, and I'm going to be writing my H this way. So this entire system now becomes deterministic. Once I have samples from normal 0, 1, then the relationship between HL minus 1 and HL is deterministic. Right? That seems trivial. So why do we need that? Okay. So now I can take this recognition model and I can say, well, instead of sampling from mean and sigma, I'm actually going to be sampling epsilons and I'm going to be rewriting it this way. Okay. So why this is useful? Well, it turns out that the recognition distribution can be expressed in terms of deterministic mapping. So this entire recognition system now becomes deterministic with these epsilons. Right? And the key idea is that these epsilons, they don't depend on parameters, right? They just samples from normal 0, 1. So you basically have a deterministic encoder, and this distribution of epsilon doesn't depend on the parameters. So why is this important? Turns out that this trick, and it's retrospectively, it seems like a trivial thing to do. And for the last 20 years, we didn't know how to do it, basically. So imagine that I'm trying to take derivative with respect to the parameters of this quantity here, right? That comes from the variational bound. What I can do is I can say, look, I can take the derivative and I can do a reorganization trick. I can say it's expectation with respect to these epsilons at different layers of this expression. And these expressions are now are deterministic functions of epsilon and x, given the epsilons. And there is something interesting happens, which is I can take this gradient and I can push it inside the expectation. That's all. This trick is basically saying, instead of computing mean, instead of computing expectation and then moving the mean, what you're doing is you're computing the gradients and then you're taking the mean, which is much more efficient because if you think about this, this entire system is deterministic. So what ends up happening is that when you compute the gradients, you can do back propagation through the whole system, right? which is very nice. So you're basically back propagating through the latent variables that are stochastic. So the gradients here can be computed by back propagation. If you didn't use that trick, the variance of this quantity is so large that you basically it's very hard to learn. So people were using reinforced algorithm and so forth, and it was never there. So this is basically an autoencoder.
Is there a good bound on the convergence of how many such epsilons you need to take in order for this to approximate the real mean that you are aiming for?
So you can think of these as not really, it's very hard to say, you know, what's the mean that you're aiming for. What you're trying to do with these gradients is you're really trying to take the gradient of the variational bound, right? And it's still going to be a Monte Carlo approximation. It's still going to be a Monte Carlo approximation because you have to sample these ones and then compute the gradients. So you instantiate these epsilons and then you're back propagating through. You know, how fast the convergence is, it still is a noisy process, right? Because you still have to do Monte Carlo approximation. But the fact that you can compute these gradients through this entire system, through this whole model, speed-wise, it's a much faster. And you can, perhaps what you could do is you can also estimate the variance of the gradients in this case. And then maybe that will tell you something about how much there is a variance. There's a big reduction variance, but I don't know whether there's been any sort of theoretical work or any specific work estimating how much noise reduction you have in terms of estimating the variance of the gradients. Gradients estimate.
Just so I understand, so you sample the epsilons once, and then you do this back propagation.
That's right.
With respect to those?
That's right. So it's almost like you have a stochastic system, and you're basically saying there's deterministic part,
right,
and there's stochastic part. And the stochastic part doesn't really depend on parameters. So I'm instantiating epsilons and doing back propagation through the whole system. That's the intuition.
So is there any notion of doing several samples and back propagating the...
Yeah, so there is actually a class of models that one of my students looked at called importance-weighted autoencoders. What you can do here is you can say instead of a single sample, you can draw multiple samples and then take the average, right? And initially, when we looked at it, and sometimes these what we call importance-weighted because this ratio of the joint with respect to Q, sometimes known as an importance weight. So we've looked at this particular instantiation, and that actually has a relation to something called multiple sample bounds. And these are normalized weights. So it turns out...
What are these importance weights again? So just that ratio?
Just that ratio. Just that ratio.
Q of H.
So think of this...
In what sense are these autoencoders? Like, what's the encoding and what's the decoding?
People call them kind of variational autoencoders for the reasons that if I sort of look back here, this Q basically is an encoder.
Right.
Given the X and given the epsilons, you encode. This P, you can think of it as a decoder, which basically, given the latent states, you decode it back. And then there is an entropy, there's another term, the entropy with respect to Q, which is essentially tries to say spread the probability mass a little bit around the latent space. It's a regularizer, that's right. So it's almost like an autoencoder, but then there's another term, the entropy term, that basically says make sure that you're spreading things out so you never get a point estimate. But it's a little bit confusing. It's just that people started calling it variational autoencoders for the reasons that there is an encoder, there is a decoder, which might not be the best way to call them, because these are autoencoders in general are not generative models. These are autoencoding. Given the input, you just try to reconstruct the input back. These are truly generative models because you can sample from the prior and can generate the data. But let me just, yeah, a question.
Q is a product distribution typically?
The what?
Q is a product distribution still? The Q is still a product distribution?
Yes. The Q is like, it can be anything you want it to be, but in general, you need to be able to compute these quantities. So it's just a neural network that goes deterministic, typically deterministic neural network. But the interesting thing about this particular formulation is that you can improve the variational bound by using k-sample importance weighting of the log likelihood. So let me call this the variational bound. And you can show that it's a low bound in the marginal log likelihood. So you can always show that this quantity here, if you're drawing multiple samples and averaging, all you're doing is you're drawing multiple samples from Q, just taking the average. You can show it's a low bound in the marginal log likelihood. So you can say this quantity here is always bounded below by log probability of X. Can you say something about the variance? Not quite. But at least it's a bound. And in special case, if k equals 1, it's the same as the variational objective. And the interesting thing here is that using more samples, you can improve the tightness of the bound. So you can show that using more samples can only improve the tightness of the bound. So you can show this statement. And in fact, as k goes to infinity, you will recover log P of X. So it's kind of an interesting, for us, it was a little bit of an interesting observation because it basically is telling you, if you're using one sample, you're always pushing on the bound. If you're using multiple samples, the bound decreases. So it's a kind of, how accurate you want to be versus how fast you want to be. And unfortunately, in the practice, how fast you are actually matters a lot. So there is a little bit of debate. Do I use one sample? Do I use 10 samples per example? Or do I use one sample for 10 examples? And in practice, using one sample for 10 examples is a little bit better. It's almost like fighting a battle with stochastic gradient descent. But nonetheless, you can show these results, and you can also show that if this quantity, if these ratios are bounded, then you can show that this can approach the actual marginal likelihood as k goes to infinity. And if you want to compute the gradients for this expression, it's exactly the same procedure. You can use the representation trick, and you can rewrite the gradients using this way. It's a little bit of it's a little algebra to do that, but that's not quite important. And these are known as normalized weights. So these are importance weights. But what's interesting is that if you look at the Monte Carlo estimate of multiple sample bound versus the variational autoencoder, these quantities are exactly the same. The only difference between the two is whether you take the average or whether you take the average with respect to important samples, right? And the intuition I want to convey here, what is this thing doing? This thing essentially is saying, if I sample 10 samples from the approximate posterior, some of them will be better, some of them will be worse, right? And that technique basically allows you to figure out which ones are better and put more weights on them. That's all it is, just like an important sampling. So in terms of compute, the both methods are about the same computational, except for here, you're just weighting things differently. So let me just give you a little motivation example, and then I'll stop. This is more of a, we're not going to look at the equations anymore. We started looking at the problem of, can you generate images from natural language descriptions? And so here's an example of a stop sign flying in blue skies. Here's an example of yellow bus flying in blue skies. Here's an example of elephants flying in blue skies, and we're very, very happy to see that sometimes it generates two things. So you can pretend those to be elephants. Commercial airplanes flying in blue skies. So the underlying model is based basically on the variational autoencoders, right? It's a conditional variational autoencoder model where you have a generative model. Given text, there is encoding of the text, very important how we encode the text, but there is a generative model, so you're generating images, just generating a sequence of patches. And there is a recognition model, so inference model. So given the ground truth, what's the posterior of these latent spaces, right? So it is a variational autoencoder, it's just chained and uses time component to it, but it's not important. So And you can train these models reasonably well, again, by using the reparentization trick. You can do fun things like a yellow school bus versus red school bus versus green school bus versus blue school bus. And you can see that it kind of changes the colors of images. So that was nice. The model is actually able to generalize a little bit. And let me just finish on this one interesting thing, which is my student who was working on it basically generated a toilet seat open in the bathroom. And then you can generate a toilet seat open in the grass field. That's actually not bad, right? It sort of captures the overall background reasonably well. It shows that, you know, based on the input, it actually does reasonably well. And then we found that Google already solved this problem. So if you actually type this query in the Google search, you get this. Right? So that was initially a little bit depressing. But if you actually, I think if you actually do the Google search here, now this image will come up before this image. So we've convinced Google that that's a much better representation for that query than this. And the reason why is because I think people were clicking more on this image to figure out what the heck is this. So we got bumped up in the priority queue. And then something interesting happened. There was a Bloomberg news that basically said that Russell Kadena, physics professor at the University of Toronto, who worked on the toilet project, said, so that was sort of, that was very funny because of this one figure, everybody's basically was a toilet project from now on. So let me take a break and we'll finish off with the last piece in half an hour. Thank you.